know that when we get ready to give our tithes and offerings, amen, we don't pass the buck all around anymore, amen. We don't catch nothing, amen, say amen.
Amen.
So what we do is we give it to either the ushers, amen, or we give it to our class leader, we give it to Brother Curtis, but amen. Remember this. I believe that first part of that statement that I hear all the time is not more important than the end that says, God says what? Try me.
Right.
Amen.
And see, when I open up the windows of heaven, come on.
Amen.
And pour out blessings. Come on, say amen.
Lord,
they haven't got room enough to receive. What am I saying? God said, try me and see when I move, and you will recognize me in your life if you do it my way. Did you catch it?
Amen.
God says, try me.
Right.
Nowhere in the Bible elsewhere God say, try me, see me. So I'm going to see if it's going to work. I'm going to see if you're going to move. Amen. Try me and see. Prove me right or wrong. Amen. And see, won't I open up the door? And I tell you all the time, as God tells through me, if God don't bless you, I will. Give me a call and say, you told me God was going to bless you, and he didn't. You're going to have to bless me, and I'll be right there to give you that blessing. Amen. Because I trust in God with all my heart. Amen.
Amen.
Let us look at the scripture reading. Amen. Again, Ephesians chapter 4.
Uh-huh.
Ephesians chapter 4. Amen. Ephesians chapter 4. Amen. See, another young man is coming in. Good to see you. Praise the Lord. Everybody give a wave. Good to see you. Amen. Praise God. Amen. It's always good to see another face in the house of the Lord, and know that we love you. We love you for the love of Christ. Amen. Anything that we can and will do, you let us know. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Ephesians chapter 4. We there? Say amen.
Amen.
You want us to wait? Say wait. Ephesians chapter 4. And I'm going to start at verse 11. Verse 11. It says, so Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, the teachers. He gave us them to equip his people for the work of the church, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in knowledge of the Son of God, and become mature, say mature.
Mature.
Attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ.
Yeah.
Then we will no longer, say no longer.
No longer.
We will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and the blows here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceptive scheming. Have mercy.
Well.
Instead, we speak the truth in love. We will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ.
Yeah.
From him the whole body joined and held together by every supporting ligament grows and builds itself up in love. Look at your neighbor, say in love.
In love.
As each part does its work.
Thank you, Lord.
Again, the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I want to use for a subject, if you don't mind, a theme or a discussion this morning. I want to give it a title, for the edifying of the body. Look at your neighbor and say, for the edifying. Edifying on the body. You know as well as I know, it's so much going on in the religious sect, amen? There are so many divisions when it comes to the giftings that Jesus left as leadership in the church. Come on, give me an amen.
Amen.
Some denominations or religious sects are ran by apostles.
Uh-huh.
Others are ran by prophets. Others are by overseers or bishops. Then you have the pastors, you have the evangelists, you have the teachers. Some denomination says, well, there's no more apostles because there were only 13 appointed by Christ, which includes Saul of Tarsus, whom later became Paul, and Judas Iscariot, who we know, helped send Jesus to the cross. Then there are other denominations which say there are no modern day prophets because the final revelation has come to us through Jesus Christ. Then there is evangelism or evangelist, where some say it is not a specific gift and that everyone in the church acts in the capacity of an evangelist at one time or another. Then there is the pastor. Some call them elders. Some argue that this gift is only for males, that they are the true heads of the church, and the previous gift mentions evangelists are only offices, bishops, apostles, only offices or figurehead titles. And last but not least, the teacher. Most denominations, if not all, declare all members of the church can serve in this gifting because we all are teachers. The Holy Spirit works through each and every one of us once we learn the truth. Amen? Now, these arguments and opinions may or may not have merit. I believe that what's more important concerning these gifts is their purpose. Look at your neighbor and say their purpose. What purpose did Jesus have in mind when he gave us these gifts, gave these gifts to the church, the body of Christ? What were they to be used for? Well, let's go back to the Bible. Amen? And let's look at what it actually says. And I'm going to start again at verse 11 if that's all right with you. Amen?
Yeah.
It says, so Jesus himself gave us the apostles. He gave us prophets. He gave us evangelists. He gave us pastors and teachers. Isn't that what it says?
Yeah, yeah.
But it goes on and says, for the equipping, say equipping. For the equipping of the saints, that's your name, for the work of ministry. Then it doesn't stop there. He said he gave it for the edifying of the body of Christ. So our text says that the gifts were given to the saints for the work of the church. And their purpose was to do what? Edify.
Edify.
The body of Christ.
Yeah.
Are you with me this morning?
Oh, yeah.
I believe that so many of us have gotten so caught up in the gift that we have lost sight of their purpose. Come on, amen.
Amen.
The text says the purpose was to what? Edify the body. Edify the body of Christ. So what does it mean to edify the body of Christ? How do you edify someone? What was so important, or why would it be so important to Jesus that the church be edified? And what does it mean to be edified? Well, edified means to instruct. Look at your neighbor and say to instruct.
Instruct.
Edified means to improve someone morally or intellectually. It means to educate. It means to teach, to school, to tutor, to train, to guide. It means to enlighten. It means to inform. It means to indoctrinate or to be made better. Come on, somebody say amen.
Amen.
One definition doesn't stop there. It adds something in there. It says especially, look at your name and say especially.
Especially.
Especially in moral and religious knowledge.
Yes.
Ooh, somebody say amen.
Amen.
Another adds in, it is also edifying to uplift people, to enlighten people, to inform people, to build people, and to establish people. This word edify has its roots from a Latin word which means to instruct or improve spiritually. Are you with me?
Yeah.
I don't have time to argue on which gift we have or have not given. I don't know what God is calling one to or one another to. God gives that calling to you. But what my job is, amen, what my vocation is, and what our vocation is as saints of the body, is to teach, to instruct. That, and we're going to talk about that in a minute, for a reason. Amen? Our text agrees with the definition because it goes on to say, till we all come to what? Unity of the faith and of knowledge of the Son of God. Y'all hearing what it says?
Yes, sir.
A perfect person or a perfect man, to measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Understanding God, how he works, why, understand why Christ does what Christ does. We as saints are equipped with these gifts to instruct the body. That's what it's simply saying. To improve the body morally and intellectually. Morally meaning in a way that is considered right according to the code of behavior of the body of Christ. Intellectually meaning in their understanding of Christ, in their understanding of God, in their learning, in their thinking, in their mental perception of things. So why is edifying the church important? Well, our text goes on and to say, and as I told you before, you don't have to search for the answer. The answer's always in the text.
Amen?
We don't have to look in the crystal ball. Amen? But do nothing like that. If you read the word and the context is in, it will tell you what it's trying to say. Look at your neighbor and say amen.
Amen.
Our text goes on and it says this. It says that we should no longer be children. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm not a child anymore.
I'm not a child.
It goes on to that we might not be tossed to and fro and carried away with every wind and doctrine. Everybody believe in this, don't believe in that, don't believe. Come on, amen. Y'all know what I'm talking about.
Oh, yeah.
It says, by the trickery of men, you know folk will trick you, in the cunning craftiness and the deceptive plotting.
Yeah.
Is that me? Amen. Up there. Hey, Jesus. Oh, yeah. Amen. The NRS, or the New Revised Standard Version, as the preacher read the scripture, says it this way. It says, we must no longer be children tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind and doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness and deceptive scheming.
Hey.
I personally like the Amplified Version. The Amplified Version Bible puts it this way. So we are no longer children spiritually immature, tossed back and forth like ships on a stormy sea, and carried away by every wind of shifting doctrine. If it sounds good, it makes me feel good, I'm going with that. Come on, amen. By the cunning and trickery of unscrupulous men, and by the deceptive scheming of people ready to do anything for their personal profit. Come on, y'all. Know what I'm talking about.
Oh, yeah.
Amen?
Oh, yeah.
We have lost, as a body, the sight of the purpose of the gift that Christ bestowed upon us for the body of Christ. The body must be morally and intellectually mature, and it cannot embody this transformation without the edifying of the body by the leaders, come on, by the leaders that Jesus has put in place. Jesus just called it, amen. We have gotten so caught up in how we feel. That we have downgraded the most important facet of being the body of Christ.
Yeah.
Don't you know anger is how you feel? Come on.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Happiness is how you feel.
Yeah.
And it comes and it goes. Come on.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. You can always go by what you feel. Amen. A good song will have you moving. Come on, I can hoop and have you jumping. Come on, I can do all that thing. But if you got that knowledge, if you have that understanding, the body must be morally and intellectually mature. Amen? We've gotten so caught up. So caught up. I constantly hear people saying that they're leaving their church because they don't feel nothing. Oh, y'all say ouch. Come on, amen. Jesus' final charge to us is referred as the Great Commission. Look at the neighbor and say the Great Commission. Great. Jesus has said to us, go out to all the nations. Remember? And make disciples, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you.
Thank you, Lord.
That I have given you. See, in this process of teaching or edifying the body, we learn the truth of Christ. We learn who Christ is. We learn what the Father has done through him for us. We learn how we should carry ourselves and how Jesus operates through us.
Yes.
The truth will save us, will make us free.
Amen.
Once you have the truth, what? You are free. You can't be fooled no more. You can't be deceived anymore. And once we are equipped, enlightened, taught, instructed concerning the truth, we no longer are being tossed to and fro. You know what the scripture says?
Yeah.
And carried by every doctrine, by trickering men or women in cunning craftiness or deceptive plotting.
Yes.
We will be able to recognize those who are deceptive and have a personal agenda other than empowering the body of Christ.
Thank you, Lord.
We are preparing ourselves for the return of our Lord and Savior. We are preparing ourselves for the rapture. We're preparing to be taken up. We're preparing ourselves to be changed into whatever and however Jesus is like.
Thank you.
Read your scriptures. Amen.
Amen.
Deception, though, can manifest itself in not only people who are deceiving, but in twisting the truth. Look at your name and say, twisting the truth. They use the truth to divide us as a body. Because they know that when two or three come together, you have to be catching, touching, and agreeing in the truth. Who's in the midst? Jesus is in the midst. When two or three come touching, agreeing, and we see something going wrong, we go and tell our God. We go and tell our Savior. We go and tell our Father what's going on. And God says, if you know that he hears us, God will take care of the situation, the circumstances. If we are touching and agreeing, we know how to wait. Come on. Wait on the Lord. We don't go forward or backward. We wait on what God tells us that we should be doing.
Thank you, Lord.
Deception can use the truth to break down instead of building up. Instead of uplifting, they use the truth to separate rather than to unite the body. The Bible is more than a The Bible is more than a Baptist, it's more than a Methodist, it's more than an Episcopal, it's more than a Kojic, it's more than any of the denominations, any of the religious sect. It is more than
more than that.
Their preaching and teaching will cater to our itch and ears. It'll cater to our biases, what we're not comfortable being around. It'll cater to our prejudices. And it lacks the love that God has for God's people. And you say, what are you talking about? I know what John 3:16 says. Do you know what it says?
Yeah.
It says, for God so what? Loved the world.
Yeah.
Not just you. Not just me. Not just the people that member all these churches. It says, for God so what? Loved the world. That whosoever believeth, whosoever receiveth, not just you, not just me, not just our type of sin. God says, if you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you start giving power, you start getting edifying, you start doing that, Jesus got it. Y'all catch it?
Yes, sir.
God has died. He sent his son to die on the cross. Your sins are covered. You are what? Counted as the righteous. Y'all catching it this morning?
Yes.
that if you believe in him, you will have life. And you will have it more abundantly.
Yeah.
It says if you believe in him, Jesus has given us the power to become the children of God. Not just you, not just whoever believes has become the children of God. That through him they can go before the throne of grace and mercy. Pass our prejudices. Pass our bias. Pass our judgment. They can go to the throne of mercy and say, God, Father, Abba, and God will hear them. God will listen to them. Because God goes by our hearts, not what's going on outside. And mostly, God, while we're here, Jesus didn't come just to cover our sins, just to bring us back to God, but the Bible says Jesus came that we might have life. Oh, yeah, I'm not catching it. And having what? More abundant. I'm tired of being miserable. I'm tired of being depressed. I'm tired of carrying weight I don't need to carry. If I turn it over to the Lord.
Turn it over.
Come on, if I believe that God got me,
man.
No matter what the situation looks like, no matter what the circumstances are, no matter how I got there, if I believe, if I trust in the Lord, I can have life.
Every life.
And have it more abundantly. I'm going to be not scared to walk outside my door. I'm not going to be scared to not work where I'm working. I'm not going to be scared of you, and nobody else going to be smart enough to stay away from me if I need to stay away from you. Come on, man. I am going to have life. Look at your neighbor and say, I want to have life.
I want to have life.
I want to have life and have it more abundantly. And when somebody trying to taste my joy away, I say, this joy that I have, the world didn't give it to me, my money didn't give it to me, the job didn't give it to me, my mama, my sister, my brother, the world didn't give it to you. None of y'all, if I can't say what I want to say, can take it away.
Yeah.
I need to hear what edifying the body does for you, what truth does for you, with knowing what God wants us to be and how God wants to carry us.
There you go.
Look at the scripture, read that scripture, see that scripture, pray about that scripture.
Oh, yes.
The remainder of our text says, but speaking the truth in love. Did you hear the word love?
Uh-huh.
How many people see folk criticizing folk, putting them down, talking about them? We all supposed to be together. We all supposed to be a part of the body. We are all God's children. I don't have time to put you down because there's so many people out there that need to be edified. So many people need to be made disciples. So many people need to be brought to Christ. So many people need to know that Christ loves them just the way they are. When they come in, God will do what God wants to do. I'm just going to tell you, but there is a God.
There is God.
That loves you. Beyond your faults and beyond your needs. There are so many divisions when it comes to the giftings that Jesus left as leadership in the church. And this theologian, I can say that, amen. Opinion is the gift is not more important than what it was given for.
Yes, sir.
Let us begin to fulfill the purpose for which God has called us into leadership for in God's church. Let us begin empowering the church morally and intellectually. And we must keep in our forefront of our thinking that God's thoughts are not our thoughts.
Right.
Nor is God's ways our ways.
Yeah.
Let us edify the body of Christ in love, not judgment, not opinion, in love. For God so loved the world that the sacrifice, the blood of Jesus, the Lamb, come on, has covered us. All we got to do is accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Come on. Let us edify the church that it can be united. Let us edify the church that it will recognize false prophets.
Yeah.
Yes.
It will recognize deceptive teachers.
Yeah.
It will recognize cunning and treacherous apostles. Mm-hmm. It will recognize those prophet-seeking evangelists and antichrist pastors.
Yeah.
Folk that want to be God and you to worship them. Our text says in Ephesians chapter 4 that God has given all these gifts that we might be instructed, that we might be edified, that we might not be tossed to and fro.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Look at your neighbor and say, for the edifying of the body.
Edifying of the body.
I pray that God has given you a word today. Notice that I didn't put any denomination down, did I?
Oh, no.
I didn't put down any gifting, did I?
No.
I said God gave us all the giftings, however we decide to do what we need to do, if we're following God's instructions. But remember, God said false prophets will come. Mm-hmm. Antichrists will come.
They will. Yes.
Deceptive teachers will come. People will be there for profit. Not your profit, their profit. People will have pockets for your profit. Yeah. People will sell you blessings. Come on, amen.
Yeah.
But God says, if we as leaderships will edify the body, empower you to see, empower you to sense, empower to you to know when all this is happening, then you will be one of love. You won't be pushed to the side. You won't leave your church. Come on, amen. You will build where God has set you. You will grow where God has set you. And you will go out among all the nations,
yes,
and make disciples, mm-hmm, teaching them that for God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten son, that you don't have to get ready. You don't have to get right. You don't have to put yourself in position. All you have to say, Lord, here I am. I confess with my mouth and I believe in my heart that you sent your son Jesus and that Jesus died for my sins. And Jesus didn't just die, but he rose from the dead. He conquered death that I might not be afraid when it's my time to come. Amen. That he has given us the power to become the sons and daughters of God. That is the opening of the doors of the church if you stand. All you have to do is come, just as you are, and say, Lord, here I am with all my mistakes, all my frailties, all my shortcomings. Here I am, God. I want to give my life over to you. Oh, God, you blessed me. God, you kept me. God ain't had no worry, but I want to give my life over to you that I might be used by you. Come on, amen. To do what it needs to be done. So the doors of the church are open. Will there be one to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior? And as we listen to our hymn of invitation, let the Holy Ghost speak to your mind. Let the Holy Ghost speak to your heart, to your soul.
Yes.
And if you already know Jesus, you want to come and recommit your life over to Christ. Not join nobody in church. Let's recommit your life back over to Christ. Now is the time as well. Say, Lord, I've been out there. I kind of went this way, that way. But I want to renew my covenant with you. I want a fresh anointing. I want to recommit myself over to you. Now is the time. Will you come and recommit your life over to Christ? Will you come? Now is the time. If you want to stand for somebody else, Lord, my son, Lord, my daughter, Lord, my husband, Lord, I want to stand in for my neighbor. Lord, I want to stand for someone else. Come and stand and we'll call on the Lord for them, for the prayers of the righteous. Come on. Avail of much. If you need prayer for yourself, amen, we ask that you will come now as well and allow God to minister to you in your situation and in your circumstances. This is the time. Will you come? Come on, give the Lord a hand. That will come and stand and pray and let us touch and agree with you that God will work it out, that God will bring you through, that all things will work together for your good. Will you come? If you're looking for a church home, this is a mighty good place to be as well. We're not perfect. God is transforming us into what we need to be. Your time is coming, amen. Come and join our family, Lord. If there's any here that's been here but did not give themselves back over for full membership, now's the time. Come, stand, and we'll make you full membership of the church. Now is the time. If God is calling you to a higher heights, to be an officer, to be a preacher, to be an evangelist, to be whatever God is calling you to be. You might not know, but God, you know God's calling. Come and accept your calling, and we'll pray that God will make it clear what God is calling you to. For all those that are out there in the virtual world, if you want to accept Christ as your Lord and Savior, just repeat after me. Say, Lord, here I am. I give myself over to you. I believe that you are God's only begotten Son. I believe that you died for my sins. Come, be with me. Let me be a part of the kingdom. And if you said that, you are now accepted into the fold. You are now part of the body of Christ. And if you've done this, let us know. Write us a letter, amen. Send us an email, amen. Let us know that you have accepted the Lord as your Lord and Savior. If you want to become a virtual member, that means you don't have to move. You can be right where you are. We'll take you in as a virtual member. You'll have the rights and lights and benefits of here at Camp Hope AME Church, located at 114 Camp Hope Church Road. If you want to be a covenant member, support us in all that we do. We ask that you would let the Lord use you to be the resources to do all that God is calling us to do. We just thank you. If you're in our local area, come visit us. Come see us. And let us know you're there. You may be seated out there. The door is still open. You want to come? You can come now. We'll kneel with you and we will pray. Hallelujah. Oh God, Lord Jesus. You know the situation and the circumstances, Lord, we call on you for a difference.
Yeah.
We call on you. Touch, Lord, cover, Lord, in the name of Jesus. For it's through you that all things are possible, Lord. And you told us to come, ask, seek, and knock, Lord. You said, come to the elders in the situation of some. She has come, Lord, and we're touching and agreeing. You said if you touch and agree, you'll be with her. You'll be in a situation or circumstance. You will answer a prayer. You will let her know that she can boldly come at any time, in any place, as one of your children, and you will.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Tonight.
Thank you, Lord. Will.
Bring her through and let her know that no matter what she's going through, every door will be open around her. She can walk right out of it and give her her choice.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
You'll make a way out of nowhere. You'll make a way out in the midst of temptation. You'll make a way out in the midst of death. You'll make a way out when you don't know which way to turn.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you. I'm first.
Let it be done, Lord.
Let it be done.
As we touch and agree.
Thank you, Lord.
Here. We pray this in the matchless name of Jesus.
Jesus.
And we're all in agreement. If we're in agreement, let's say amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
My sister Godhead, just trust him.
Trust him.
He has.
Yes.
answer. He answered. You need us, you let us know. We're right here. You already declared yourself family, so that you in now. Amen.
Amen.
And you don't have to worry about us judging.
Amen.
Putting on a judge hat. Amen. We know that God is a God. It has no respect of person. Amen. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap. Amen. Hallelujah. Now prepare for our Holy Communion service. Those that are out there in virtual world, get your crackers or get your wine and water, get your bread, whatever you need as we prepare for our communion service. Ye that do truly and honest repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbor and intend to lead a new life following the commandment of God and walking from henceforth in his holy way. Let us together recite our general confession. For we know that when we come for our comfort. And we make ourselves humbly before God as we confess to the Almighty God in our minds and in our hearts, as we kneel before God's throne that is within us. Let us say together, Almighty God, Father our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we renounce and commit our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed. By thought, word, and deed against thy divine majesty, provoking with justice thy wrath and indignation against us. We do honestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of those who grieve is unto us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please you in the newness of life. To the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, whom of thy great mercy have promised forgiveness of sin to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto thee, let us say, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm our faith and strengthen us in all goodness, and bring on us to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, unto whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we shall at all times and in all places give thanks unto you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your holy name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Glory be to you, O Lord, Most High.
Amen.
table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord whose property is to always have mercy. Grant us, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and drink his blood that our sinful souls and bodies may be made clean by his death, washed through his blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us.
Amen. 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 Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, whom of thy tender mercy did give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death on the cross for our redemption, who made thereby his oblation of himself once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute in his holy gospel, commanded us continue a perpetual memory that his precious death until his coming again. Let us shout, hear us!
Hear
us, O merciful Father. We, hallelujah, most humbly beseech thee and grant that we, receiving these bread, these creatures of bread and of wine according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, holy instituted in remembrance of his death and passion, may be, hallelujah, most blessed body and blood, who in the same night that he betrayed him took bread. And when he had blessed it, he gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, says, take, eat, drink, ye all of it, for this is my blood, the blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for remission of sin. Do this as often as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me. Of sin, let us open, let us hold it up and let us drink together. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
It was my Savior's blood, oh yeah.
It was my Savior's blood,
oh yeah.
It was my Savior's blood for me. One day when I was lost,
oh yeah,
he died upon the cross,
and I know it was. Somebody give away. Our prayer. Let us say,
Amen. Amen.